Hi, I'm here talking today to Dr. Mikhail Blagoskloni. He is a scientist who studies aging, a professor of oncology, and advocate of rapamycin. I've spoken to him before, and we're going to continue our conversation here again today. And thanks for coming on, Mikhail. It's good to have you on again.
Thank you, Dennis. It's my pleasure talking to you always.
Thanks a lot. So let's jump right in. You began your scientific career studying cancer, and you are a professor of oncology. So how did that lead to your studying aging? And in particular, how did that lead to studying rapamycin in connection with aging?
I was studying senescence of cancer cells, senescence, induction of senescence by anti-cancer drugs, because I was working on anti-cancer therapy. And surprisingly, rapamycin prevented senescence instead of inducing it. But it was not by chance observation. I had a hypothesis that cellular senescence developed when cell cycle is blocked, so cells cannot divide, but growth promoting pathways like mTOR and MAPK still active, driving, I would say, futile growth, pathological growth, which I call geroconversion, which leads from reversible arrest to irreversible senescence. So then we were looking for testing this hypothesis, which pathways involved, and we used several inhibitors of MECMAP pathway, PI3 kinase, mTOR pathway, and the best drug that inhibited geroconversion to senescence was rapamycin. I also focused on rapamycin because it was clinically available drug, in contrast to MEK inhibitors that were not available at the time. And we tested it by measuring reversibility of cell cycle arrest, which was golden market. So then I realized that this is not only in vitro phenomena, but also organismal phenomena, that mTOR may be involved in organism aging. It was like analogy. In cell culture, when proliferation is blocked, then mTOR drives senescence. And in organism, when development growth is completed, then the same pathways drive organismal aging and diseases, age-related diseases. And I moved from cancer research to aging research. And fortunately, I was not indoctrinated by aging research before. So I was free to think that aging is not caused by accumulation of molecular damage, which is accumulates, of course, but and would kill organism, but it's not life-limiting. So organism dies from hyperfunctional mTOR-driven aging. As an example, mTOR is not the only pathway that involved, of course. So, and pathways that drive cellular senescence are actually identical to pathways that make cell cancer. But in cancer cells, these pathways like mTOR are activated by mutations, for example, PI3 kinase. In senescence or senescence, I sometimes pronounce senescence, sometimes senescence. How would you pronounce?
I would say senescence.
So I will say senescence too. So in senescence, the same pathway is activated by some feedback loops and so on, not by mutations. Basically, I'm answering this question.
Okay, and let me ask you a follow-up. If this doesn't take us too far afield, because it's not necessarily concerned with aging, but does your insight into cancer and its analogy with senescence, does that relate at all to the idea of cancer as a metabolic disease rather than something that's mostly driven by genetic mutations?
Well, actually, one doesn't exclude another, because these genetic mutations happen in metabolic pathways. Well, of course, cellular organism metabolism also affected. For example, in mice, fasting delays cancer, or calorie restriction delays cancer. The same rapamycin, which also change metabolic pathways, and it delays cancer in mice. And some scientists even think that it's not that rapamycin suppress aging of the organism, but it just delays cancer, so mice lives longer. But there are many arguments against this. It's probably, and I named one of my articles, inhibiting cancer, prevention of cancer by inhibiting aging. So cancer is age-related disease, and if we inhibit aging of the organism, I use the word aging for organism and senescence for cells, then we delay cancer, age-related diseases, and all other diseases.
Okay. All right. Very good. All right. Thanks for that. You made some discoveries earlier that were more or less recently rediscovered. Could you talk about some of those?
Yes. So I would say that my work was not probably well understood by aging researchers. Because I moved to this field from oncology, and something that was obvious for me was not probably obvious for aging researchers. So recently, rapamycin was announced xenomorphic because it's inhibit hypersecretory phenotype of senescent cells, and SASP. And this is like a marker of senescence. But when we were working on this 16 years ago and later, we found that it prevents, most importantly, geroconversion from normal cells to senescent cell. And we used this marker like SASP. I never considered it even important because it was expected that anti-inflammatory agent like rapamycin would inhibit SASP. I thought it would not be convincing in our work. So we mostly used golden marker that we prevent an irascibility of senescence. And also large morphologies, cell morphology and beta gal and so on, but mostly that we rapamycin maintained ability of cells to restart proliferation when cell cycle is released. So, and for that reason, I called these drugs, it's not only rapamycin, but like MEK inhibitor, gerosuppressants or gerosuppressants. The reason, because rapamycin was known as immunosuppressant, so I changed to gera. And glucocorticoids, and for example, anti-inflammatory agents also inhibit SASP, but in no way glucocorticoids extend lifespan. So this focusing on SASP is, it's only one of hyperfunctions. There are thousands of hyperfunctions besides SASP, which happening in all cells, depending what they are doing in the organism. It's, SASP is more or less universal, but it's not the only one. Another example, what was rediscovered, so-called geroscience hypothesis, which basically I described in many papers, like we titled treatment of age-related diseases but slowing down aging and validation of anti-aging drugs by treating age-related diseases and so on. And it seemed to me also obvious at the time. So, and it was known, this was discussed even before my work, that inhibiting aging would delay age-related diseases. So now it's known as hyperfunction hypothesis. So there are some other examples, but probably I don't want to take too much time on that.
Okay, so you had this idea and hyperfunction theory and how it related to senescence and the hyperfunction of all other cells, and right. It was new to aging science. You injected this new idea into aging science. I've read all of your papers on aging, and I certainly don't think there are many other people in the field who are discussing it much or emphasizing it in any case. So yes, that's all very interesting that you brought these fresh ideas into the study of aging.
Right.
Is that a good characterization of the way it is, I described it?
Right. But also hyperfunction theory made many testable predictions, which I published in most complete paper in 2006. And in 4 years after this publication, I also published about hyperfunction theory 4 years later. So at that time already was shown that predictions are working, including that rapamycin extends lifespan in mice. First paper was by Harrison, published in Nature in 2009. And we also published 1 year later in American Journal of Pathology, life extension. And then it was like 40 publications of life extension. And some effects were very dramatic. And I like some papers by Matt Comberlin also later on that show that the higher dose of rapamycin, the longer life. So it's never reached plateau. So it's important. But I would not say that no one at all accepted this. It was few peoples, but they were, for example, David Jones from London. He developed it further, hyperfunction theory, quasi-programmed diseases to C. elegans. He showed that C. elegans also die from H-related diseases, but they, of course, very different from human diseases, but it was completely like hyperfunction theory predicted. So, and also one doctor in practicing doctor accepted this. It was Alan Green, who started treating himself with rapamycin, and then effect was so dramatic. Probably you can read on his website this story. So now he's treating 700 patients. So it's not really necessary that everyone accepted. It's important that those people who accepted, they can develop it further.
Right. Okay. And let me just for the benefit of those watching and listening, let me just state more plainly that Dr. Blagosklony once wrote that if rapamycin does not extend lifespan, then everything we know about biology is wrong. And of course, Dr. Blagosklony was completely right in his prediction. So I think that shows incredible insight. What you mentioned, Dr. Green, Dr. Alan Green in New York, what would you say is the significance of him starting to treat patients with rapamycin in terms of the bigger picture, in terms of more widespread recognition or use of rapamycin?
Yes, it was turning point, because otherwise medical doctors would be afraid to do this. So he showed example. It was very bold to start such practice at the beginning. So now other doctors accepted this. He showed that it's very safe and effective. And at least, I know at least five, six clinics in US and heard about some clinics in Europe that use rapamycin for life extension. But I think there are a lot of them now opening. And it's very different, like it was 15 years ago. One doctor from one famous university told me that he's taking one tablet per week, 1 milligram, which is very low, and that he keeps it in secret, even from his wife. So this is how it was before bold actions of Dr. Green.
Okay, very interesting. And yes, like you say, there are more now that are doing that, more doctors prescribing it. I've seen, I don't know, like half a dozen or so doctors around. I'm guessing there are probably many more that are maybe not so public with their willingness to prescribe rapamycin. Do you see rapamycin as the most important anti-aging intervention currently available now? And what other promising anti-aging interventions, if any, do you see coming along in the near future, say in the next decade?
Yes. So some of them very close to rapamycin. It's, for example, Rapaloc and Everolimus. It has some advantages that it have shorter half-life. So you can better regulate to induce high level, but it will be for short time. It could be have some advantages. And also, non-specific inhibitors of PI3 kinase and mTOR simultaneously. Dr. Manik develops this. It's these compounds also inhibit GER conversion in cell culture. Besides inhibitors of mTOR and MEK, now they're also clinically available. Very interesting results on life extension. Not so many drugs extend life in mice, by the way. It's more talking about this, but no data. So drugs that extend lifespan in mice repeatedly is acarbose, which you know very well, of course, and alpha estradiol. It's not beta estradiol, which make feminized effect. And about acarbose, it's basically close to very low calorie diet. It prevents, let's say, absorption of carbs. So in my mind, it can be substituted a carbose with a ketogenic diet, a very low carb diet. And But alpha estradiol is unique. It's probably has no similar effects, not the same effects as any fasting or low carb or whatever. And it's different from rapamycin. So this is very interesting. But it extends lifespan only in male mice. But men live shorter than women. And although it could be used probably mostly for men, for longevity, it's also important. What else will be coming? I don't know. Because it's unpredictable. Discoveries are unpredictable. Otherwise, they are not discoveries. Otherwise, we already know them now. Actually, I like your ideas about iron and in aging. So I think that some agents or interventions that decrease excessive iron, excessive it's against hyperfunction, maybe will work. But I don't want to speculate too much on that.
Well, yes, you're totally right. I mean, if we could anticipate this, the discoveries, they wouldn't be discoveries. Yes, acarbose is very interesting because basically it mimics a low carbohydrate diet. Right. So yeah, that's definitely of interest. You recently expressed some skepticism about the benefits of metformin in terms of lifespan extension. And could you talk a little bit about this?
Yes, I wouldn't say that this is skepticism. It's just hype about metformin is exaggerated, this basically. I was very positive about, I'm still positive about metformin, but especially 16 years ago, at that time, it was very convincing data from one Russian university on prevention of cancer and extension of lifespan. But now I realize that it's mostly in cancer-prone mice, which is, of course, very important. But further studies in normal mice give some mixed results. For example, famous paper that said that metformin extends lifespan in mice actually showed that in one, it was two doses used, one high, one moderate or low. So that high dose actually shortened lifespan and significantly, but low dose slightly extended. So, but metformin showed some clinical benefits for several age-related diseases like cancer, diabetes, obesity, and so on. So I consider that it's probably anti-aging drug, but at the same time, it has no effect on cellular senescence. So mechanism of action completely unknown. I would say that it's 1,000 mechanisms now, including action of gut bacteria, which is very unexpected, but this is one. So it works on organismal action level, and it's not even clear what is its target. So metformin probably would be most effective in combination with rapamycin for many reasons that I described previously. Surprisingly, there is no complete study of this combination. It was one study on lifespan, but this study lacks rapamycin control. Yes. So
metformin is interesting from the point of view of it affecting gut bacteria or maybe other aspects of the gut. This seems to be one of the main ways it works, and it makes a lot of sense of the other research, because much of the research has been done in cell cultures in which the doses used are not physiological or not even attainable in humans taking metformin. So there have been all of these, for example, effect of metformin on mitochondria. This is one mechanism that has been talked about a lot, but it seems that in doses normally used in human beings, the levels would never get that high to affect mitochondria. And then there was that interesting study where they used some kind of extended release metformin versus regular metformin to determine how much was absorbed and what the effects were. And they figured that most, if not all, of the effects of metformin had to do with the effects on the gut. It makes sense to me, this is just my idea here, but it makes sense to me that more or less sporadic use of metformin might be helpful because of its effects on the gut.
Long ago in the past, I thought that metformin is acting by slight inhibition of mTOR pathway through AMPK. Yes, this effect may exist in organism, but now I don't think it's the main effect, because it's very weak actually. In cell culture, metformin working sometimes in opposite fashion than rapamycin. They have very little in common. So, but talking about this, we mentioned already several times low carb diet or ketogenic diet, or yes, and I think it's also very important in conjunction with rapamycin to have right diet and physical exercise. And actually, you're expert on this combination of physical exercise and low carb diets. So, as all of us, I was raised believing that we should not eat red meat and eggs. Well, I was eating eggs all my life, despite that, of course.
But you ignored that part about yes, the eggs.
Yeah, and about meat, I also ignore it. But I also was eating a lot of carbs, and including all desserts, a lot of ice cream, and so on and so on. So then I was studying this more, and I realized that I was wrong. Well, it's not that I was wrong, but nutrition science. So I switched on low carb diets myself, and in combination with rapamycin, I lost extra weight. I start exercising. I got muscles. I can now made several pull-ups, which I was
unable. Excellent. To.
Yes, I would show you, but maybe after interview, how I do this. And I'm very happy with this combination. Of course, sometimes when I am stressed, I do some exceptions and eat sometimes ice cream, but not often.
Okay, okay, great. Yes, I mean, to me, the when you see the connection between, for example, diabetes and aging, that you can see that this accelerates aging, in turn, aging accelerates the prevalence of diabetes. It's my belief that staying fit with, you know, relatively low amount of body fat and relatively high amount of muscle mass, and then this giving you good insulin sensitivity, this is just one of the most important things you can do to slow aging. I'm glad to see that you've taken up all of this, the low carb and the strength training. Obviously, the world is going through this viral pandemic at the moment, COVID-19, and there have been several articles suggesting that rapamycin could have a role to play in all this in prevention or treatment, perhaps. Could you talk about that a little bit?
Yes. Many people actually simultaneously suggested that rapamycin can be useful in prevention of COVID, and maybe even in treatment, because deadly effects of COVID are due to hyperfunction of innate immune system. This is how people die, from hyperinflammation, which damages organs. But it remains, it was many publications, including mine. Mine was titled From Causes of Aging to Death from COVID. But they are still not yet confirmed, in a sense that clinical trials were started, several, but they are not published yet. At least I didn't see they published yet. So, but many people were afraid of rapamycin. And it's important that these clinical trials were started and showed at least that it's not dangerous. But final results, I didn't see. Yes.
Okay, great. And then what about, so you just actually mentioned something about this just now about side effects or possible adverse effects of rapamycin. And you've discussed some of these and how they're basically myths or they're unfounded. The basis is unfounded for the side effects of rapamycin. Could you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, these side effects are actually a myth mostly. At least people, healthy people taking rapamycin, it was clinical study, had no side effects. And the only side effect I heard from people taking rapamycin as anti-aging is temporarily mouth sores that go away after a while. But I will give you two examples about myth of rapamycin. I submitted a paper long ago, and reviewer wrote rejecting. This happened all the time. I had probably hundreds of rejections. So he wrote that rapamycin cannot be used because it rejects liver, the liver. So I was very surprised. And then I realized that reviewer looked on internet and it says that rapamycin not always prevent rejection of donor liver. Not your own, but yes. So it says that rapamycin not so good as immunosuppressant. This another example. Some maybe now not already believe that rapamycin may increase incidence of cancer and lymphoma. The reason that 20 years ago, FDA put notice. It doesn't say anything about rapamycin at all. It says that immunosuppression may lead to increased incidence of lymphoma cancer. But paradox that those who study effect of rapamycin in mice, some researchers think that the main effect of rapamycin is cancer prevention. This is why mice live longer, because cancer main cause of death in mice, lymphoma, cancer. So rapamycin and its analogs used in clinic to treat cancer. They're not, I would say, silver bullet, because I always consider it that it prevents cancer by inhibiting aging, organismal aging. So this is the main treatment. Could be more difficult, it might be too late, but it's approved because it has effect in treating cancer. It's widely used. So then other, I would say myth of side effects, but I cannot discuss all of them really. Clinical practice just shows that it's not correct because some side effects were discovered in model organisms. And maybe they are not even side effects, but positive effects. But in clinical practice, rapamycin is very safe. And for human use. So this is most important. Yes, it's weird to my mind that clinically approved drugs, which was approved 22 years ago, which taken by so many people, that safer than aspirin, actually, because no death from rapamycin would describe, but aspirin can kill by causing gastrointestinal bleeding, for example, is still investigated in mice for side effects. It makes no sense, really, because if something contradicts clinical practice for 22 years, it means that it's bad animal model. This is the only what it means. The same happened with ketogenic diet. It was publications performed in mice, and the authors warned, don't do this because it causes diabetes, which is actually completely opposite. So what do you think about that?
Yes, I think that your article discussing this idea, you were making an analogy between rapamycin and this so-called starvation diabetes was fascinating. For those that don't know, starvation diabetes occurs when someone, a human or an animal, goes without food for several days, and then if they eat something, carbohydrates would have to be involved, presumably, then glucose can appear in the urine, and this is starvation diabetes, and it's been known for a long time, 150 years or more, that this occurs. And I thought it very interesting that you make this analogy between rapamycin and this process. Some people have, and maybe it was you who said this, I don't remember, have referred to rapamycin as fasting in a pill. And so you could expect it to have the same effects as fasting. And in the case of fasting, this starvation diabetes occurs. This is obviously an extreme case. Most people don't fast for 3 days and then eat a lot of carbohydrates afterwards, but it can occur. So I think that was very interesting and to my mind, put an end to this idea that rapamycin could cause diabetes. That's not what's happening any more than fasting can cause diabetes.
Right. So rapamycin was shown in many animal studies prevents diabetic complications. So probably fasting will work, but rapamycin is very effective on this prevention. The difference between fasting and rapamycin that during fasting you don't eat by definition. But when people take rapamycin, they continue to eat. And if like fasting causes glucose intolerance, so because organism cannot utilize it to make fat from this glucose needed for brain during fasting. And when they eat, as you also said, glucose can go to urine, but people still eat when they're taking rapamycin. And if they eat a lot of carbs, it could be observed in rare cases, by the way, hyperglycemia, increase of blood glucose, which is reversible and completely benign. I think it's actually beneficial. It's the same effect as fasting, but people continue to eat. So it's very interesting would be to test combination of fasting plus rapamycin or low calories, so low carbs plus rapamycin. Many people who take rapamycin do this, but it was no systematic study, no clinical trial, or even, well, I don't think that mice is very good model for diets because their diet is so different from humans.
Some humans, there are actually quite a few humans that eat something very similar to what those mice are eating in their cages.
Yeah. So, well, it's possible to talk about myth about side effects of rapamycin all day. There are many myths. But I found it's now useless, really. Actually, Dr. Green once wrote to me that he regrets that I spent so much time on discussing the side effects, non-existent side effects, instead of continue to work positively to develop it further. So I probably shouldn't talk about this anymore.
Okay.
Because clinical practice already, not even trials, practice showing that it's irrelevant.
Gotcha, makes perfect sense. So I wanna thank you, Mikhail, for agreeing to this interview with me. It's been a very interesting and productive conversation. Thank you.
Thank you, Dennis. And thank you those who listened this interview to the very end.
Okay, great. Well, I hope I'll be talking to you soon. Thanks again. Bye now.